We are the ones that show up. We show up when there's need, we show up when there's suffering, and we show up when there's lots of uncertainties. We show up, and we show up again, and we show up again, and we show up again, right? And I think it's really only a matter of time until we will experience some form of compassion fatigue. It's not if, it's when. I want to speak for a minute to those of us who are longer-term caregivers, all right? So either informally or formally or even professionally. Now, I was speaking with a colleague not too long ago, wonderful therapist I've known for probably forever, and he said, you know, I've been thinking, and it's not a matter of if we end up experiencing vicarious trauma, it's a matter of when. I had to sit with that, and I thought, you know, I think that's probably true. It's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when. We were both probably pretty tired, and there wasn't any sign of the work letting up in the near future. I think we were both registering that fatigue, you know, when you're well beyond threshold, and the needs just keep coming. Now, all longer-term caregivers know that specific feeling. They're like 20 miles past tired, and they still have to keep going. And you know, maybe it's all starting to feel a little bit monotonous, a little bit functional, a little bit like we're going through the motions. And I think we need to be really careful when we start to sense this. So sometimes we find ourselves in that longer term caregiving role for a bunch of different reasons. Sometimes it's because we're the only one that can do it. We're the only one available. Sometimes it's because we are the person who loves this person the most in the whole world, right? Sometimes it's because we're the ones with the skills or because it's part of our profession. And for some people, it's actually all of these. At the very least, in all these cases, we are the ones who say yes. Even when there might be a big part of us that feels no, right? We are the ones that show up. We show up when there's need. We show up when there's suffering. And we show up when there's lots of uncertainties, you know? We show up, and we show up again, and we show up again, and we show up again, right? And I think it's really only a matter of time until we will experience some form of compassion fatigue. It's not if, it's when, right? But what I would say to us in this is that your yes is a sacred thing, right? And because of this, it has to be minded. It has to be protected. It has to be renewed, okay? So if your life and your work and your caregiving is going to be sort of like an instrument of the yes, yes, I will show up, and again, and again, and again, right? Well, you're going to have to polish that instrument every now and again, and you're going to have to fix any broken strings, and you're going to have to keep it in a nice, safe case. And very importantly, you're going to have to let it play a song it loves every now and again, okay? You have to take care of yourself. That's what I'm saying. Even when it feels like there's no space to do it, especially then, right? So let's take a few minutes just to answer a couple questions and see where you're at with your self-care. Okay, number one, do you get a chance to do something that you enjoy every day? What is it? Because you should. Do you have some kind of laugh every day? When? Because you should. Who do you visit with and how frequently? Are you eating well? If not, why? Are you using any substances to get through? If so, what and how frequently? What are you looking forward to? What are you looking forward to this week? What are you looking forward to this month or this year? There should be something in each of those. Are you in good health yourself? Or are you at least taking care of any health issues that you might have? How do you do that? Are you getting exercise? Does caring for your loved one bring a sense of satisfaction or meaning? Because it should. Do you feel that there are people who care about you? Can you, for instance, tell them about the things that might happen with the person you care for or your loved one that worries you or upsets you? Can you talk those things through? When and where do you experience positive emotions in your day, and what are they? How do you console yourself when it gets difficult? So when your energy is low, when you feel lonely, when you feel a bit fatigued, when you're worried about something, how do you mind yourself in that? What are your plans for the future, and who do you talk about these with? Are there any activities or moments in the day that you and your loved one are able to share and enjoy together? What are they? Are you aware of some of the things that you might miss about your life before you took on a more significant caring role? Do you ask for help? Who do you ask? Do you still keep up with current events? Are you aware of the things that are going on in the community or with your extended family? Do you feel like you have a plan and people to contact in case of an emergency situation? Do you have an active interest in your appearance? So clothing you like, haircuts, things that help you look and feel better. Do you regularly affectionately touch your loved one? As distinct from that functional care that we might be doing a lot of. So this is the pets and hugs in addition to the helping with getting dressed or administering medications, that kind of thing. Does anyone touch you? Yes, cats and dogs count. People are better. Is your environment pleasing to you? Is it tidy? Is it organized? Are there nice smells? Pictures or art that you enjoy? Cozy bedding, a chair or a corner that you can rest comfortably in, take a break in? Is there music that you like? All right. Now, some of these probably stood out a bit for you. They probably got you thinking, and here's my reflection for you. Can you identify 3 to 5 things that are manageable that you can do right now or very soon that will support your self-care? Now, these could be as simple as doing a bit of stretching in the morning, finding some music that you like, checking in with your doctor on any health issues you've been maybe meaning to address, small things. And if there are big ones, it's time to ask for help in managing those, okay? Something that I want to say to you is that if you're delivering longer-term care, you'll make mistakes, and that's okay. That's going to happen. It's actually inevitable. But when you should be very careful is when you start refusing help or pushing help away. Now, this usually occurs as a result of a mixture of kind of grief and fatigue, those two things coming together. But the longer this goes on, though, the bigger the mistakes may become. And we really kind of want to ward that off, you know? It doesn't need to get that far. So if somebody approaches you and they suggest that you might need a bit more help, or they say that they're worried about you, please do your best here to not be defensive, open up a little bit, take in what they're saying, and start to think about what kind of help you might need with them. Start attuning to your own needs. And now for those of us companioning a longer-term caregiver, here's what you can do. Number one, don't ask if you can help. Ask how, ask when, and then routinize it and follow through so that they can anticipate that help. They know it's coming, right? If they say to you, well, I don't know, start making suggestions. Annoy them a little bit with the support, right? Don't take it personal if they're having a bad day or if they're irritable with you or if they're pushing you away a bit. Just keep showing up. Another thing we can do is we can remind them of who they are outside of their caregiving. We can tell stories about them and with them outside of their caregiving. And we can find ways to keep them a part of things that are going outside of that role. Listen to feelings about the things that they can't change or the things that they can't control. There might be a need to express the grievances, to express the pain. There's a lot of things that can't be fixed or changed. Listen to the emotions that come up about that. That can be actually really hard to do. And importantly then, problem solve with them on the things that can change or the things that can be better, right? And finally, what I would say is play with them. Distract them. Do something different with them. A lot of caregiving involves doing the same things over and over, you know, well after the point where you want to be doing them sometimes. That can happen. So as best you can, try to invite a little novelty into the caregiver's world.